Our New Testament reading is found in Galatians chapter 1. Galatians chapter 1. Paul, an apostle, not of men, neither by man, but by Jesus Christ and God the Father, who raised him from the dead. And all the brethren which are with me unto the churches of Galatia, grace be to you and peace from God the Father and from our Lord Jesus Christ, who gave himself for our sins, that he might deliver us from this present evil world, according to the will of God and our Father, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. I marvel that ye are so soon removed from him that called you into the grace of Christ unto another gospel, which is not another, but there be some that trouble you and would pervert the gospel of Christ. But though we or an angel from heaven preach any other gospel unto you than that which we have preached unto you, let him be accursed. As we said before, so say I now again, if any man preach any other gospel unto you than that ye have received, let him be accursed. For do I now persuade men or God? Or do I seek to please men? For if I yet pleased men, I should not be the servant of Christ. But I certify you, brethren, that the gospel which was preached of me is not after man. For I neither received it of man, neither was I taught it, but by the revelation of Jesus Christ. For ye have heard of my conversation in time past in the Jews' religion, how that beyond measure I persecuted the church of God and wasted it and profited in the Jews' religion above many my equals in mine own nation, being more exceedingly zealous of the traditions of my fathers. But when it pleased God, who separated me from my mother's womb and called me by his grace to reveal his Son in me, that I might preach him among the heathen, immediately I conferred not with flesh and blood, neither went I up to Jerusalem to them which were apostles before me, but I went into Arabia and returned again unto Damascus. Then after 3 years I went up to Jerusalem to see Peter and abode with him 15 days. But other of the apostles saw I none, save James, the Lord's brother. Now the things which I write unto you, behold, before God I lie not. Afterwards I came into the regions of Syria and Cilicia, and was unknown by face unto the churches of Judea, which were in Christ. But they had heard only that he which persecuted us in times past now preacheth the faith which once he destroyed, and they glorified God in me. Amen. May God bless this reading of his holy word. Our text this evening is found in the book of Psalms. If you'll turn with me in your Bibles to Psalm 33, we'll be giving consideration and meditation to verse 18. So our text is Psalm 33, verse 18. Behold, the eye of the Lord is upon them that fear him, upon them that hope in his mercy. It is in our nature to desire to please those whom we love. Spouses do this, and children and parents do this, as well as friends. So how much more with the Christian? The Christian has a keen interest in pleasing his or her Lord. We desire to please God, and we're often asking ourselves the question, what is it that pleases the Lord in this context or that, in this situation or that situation? Our heart longs, and in our better moments it is accentuated. Our desire is to please the Lord who has lovingly redeemed us, and out of our gratitude, to seek to bring him glory. And there are many places in Scripture which give us very clear, very definitive descriptions of what pleases the Lord. This is one of many. Behold, the eye of the Lord is upon them that fear him, upon them that hope in his mercy. The Lord gives us a prescription. He gives us characteristics of what attracts his attention, what he notices, what he looks upon, what he is drawn to consider, what he delights in. His eye is upon these who fear him and who hope in his mercy. And so we see two beautiful things like two sides of a coin. They can't be separated. It's not the fear of the Lord by itself, nor is it the hope that we have in his mercy. But it is these two things, two sides of a coin, that are joined together, both fear and the hope of mercy. To dispose of one of them or the other would result in spiritual catastrophe. To dispose of the fear of the Lord would lead us, for example, to things like carnal presumption. But on the other hand, if we disposed of hope in his mercy, it would lead us to things like unbelieving anxiety. And both of these would be terrible for our own souls, but also displeasing to the Lord. The character of the Christian, as it is described here, has both fear and hope. And as the Lord brings these fruit out of the lives of his people, it is something that he takes delight in, something that he has pleasure in. It's a description, really, of the prosperity of our souls. So we'll consider together this theme of the object of God's eye, what it is that the Lord, who it is that the Lord looks upon, what is it that pleases the Lord, as we are given it in this particular text. So the first thing that we see is fearing the Lord. So first of all, fearing the Lord. Behold, the eye of the Lord is upon them that fear him. Gerhardus Voss, the biblical theologian of the early 20th century, said that the fear of the Lord, or the fear of Jehovah, was the generic name for true religion in the Old Testament. So it was synonymous with what it meant to be a believer, to be a God-fearing person. It was synonymous with what it was to hold to the true and biblical revelation that God had given to his people. Now, this has been the case even unto recent days, not so much in the present context, but we would talk about a God-fearing woman or a man who fears the Lord. And this was common to speak of a Christian who was exercised and earnest in their faith. Professor Murray, John Murray, described the fear of the Lord as the soul of godliness, S-O-U-L, the soul of godliness. And that, too, I think, is borne out by the pages of Scripture. In the book of Proverbs, we learn that the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom, not the advanced levels of wisdom, the beginning. That the fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge, that true knowledge of God and of ourselves and of the world is rooted in this fundamental of the fear of the Lord. And it is something that has attracted the Lord's pleasure. We can see this in many, many places, but we read it just this past Lord's Day. So let me remind you, in Malachi, our Old Testament reading, in chapter 3, toward the end, it says in verse 16, "Then they that feared the Lord spake often one to another, listen, and the Lord hearkened and heard it. And a book of remembrance was written before him for them that feared the Lord and that thought upon his name. They shall be mine, saith the Lord of hosts, in that day when I make up my jewels." The Lord is saying he was prizing those in the day of Malachi and his ministry of prophecy. He was prizing those who walked in the fear of the Lord. Now, there are some who think, well, very good. We can see that in the Old Testament. Certainly, that was a prevalent theme there. But I would put to you, and it is unequivocally true, irrefutably true, that it is just as much a characteristic of the New Testament. So when we see a description of the early church in the book of Acts, for example, how is the church described? Well, look at Acts 9, verse 31. "Then had the churches rest throughout Judea and Galilee and Samaria." So we're speaking about the church as a whole. "And were edified, and walking in the fear of the Lord and in the comfort of the Holy Ghost were multiplied." Now, this is then expanded as we come into the epistles. We see, for example, Paul frequently referring to the fear of the Lord and in a variety of contexts. So he'll take something as simple as a man fulfilling his calling in the workplace. And when he's describing, you know, the servant in relationship to his master, what's underlined there is the fear of the Lord. Same thing is true, of course, of women, because in that very well-known, often repeated description of the woman of virtue in Proverbs 31, there's all sorts of industrious things listed, but the capstone, the real jewel, is that she is a woman who fears the Lord. And so you can see that this is something that is found throughout the Bible as a whole. And the fear of the Lord is that reverential trust that is exercised before the presence of God. So the fear of the Lord, as I've described it in times past, is a sense of the majesty of God. So it begins with our eyes peering into the divine glory. And we see there this transcendent majesty that belongs to him as he's revealed himself in his word. And there's a sense of the august glory that is attached there. But coupled with that, rather than being something far removed, coupled with that is the pervasive sense of his presence with us. So this majestic, transcendent God is ever present with us. We are walking, thinking, speaking, conducting our lives in the presence of this holy and altogether glorious God. And you could add to that as well, a consciousness or a knowledge of what God requires of us. So, for example, that which is summarized in his moral laws, we see in the Ten Commandments and so on. What is it that the Lord requires of us as his creatures, as those who have been made by him and for him? And these are components which contribute to this biblical concept of the fear of God. And we see this in many, many different places. So that first mark of the sense of the majesty of God is borne out lots of different places in the book of Psalms. One would be Psalm 89, where we read in verse 6, "For who in the heaven can be compared unto the Lord? Who among the sons of the mighty can be likened unto the Lord? For God is greatly to be feared in the assembly of the saints, and to be had in reverence of all them that are about him." We see that fearing the Lord is attached or coupled with this sense of the incomparable glory of God. We see the same thing in the New Testament in Luke chapter 12 and verse 5. It also carries with it, as I say, a sense of his presence with us, that we are actually standing, living, thinking in the presence of God himself. One example of this would be in Amos chapter 3 and verse 8. It says there, and it's speaking in verse 7, "Surely the Lord God will do nothing, but he revealeth his secret unto his servants the prophets, the lion that roared. Who will not fear? The Lord God hath spoken, but who can but prophesy?" And then we have, of course, this third part, which is a sense of what God requires of us. And again, we can turn here to many, many places, but Psalm 4 would be one, verse 4, "Stand in awe and sin not. Commune with your own heart upon your bed and be still." So stand in awe and sin not. There's this fear, a godly fear, of offending the Lord, being conscious of what he requires and a desire to in no way offend him. You remember in Hebrews chapter 12 how this is brought out in that context with regards to the chastening of the Lord. But all of this is part and parcel with what it means to fear the Lord. Now, only the Christian fears the Lord. Only the Christian has godly, believing, reverential fear for the Lord. The wicked do not have this. If you look just one page over, Psalm 36, verse 1, "The transgression of the wicked saith within my heart that there is no fear of God before his eyes." The Apostle Paul says the same thing in Romans chapter 3. So the unbelieving, unconverted, ungodly people have no fear of God before their eyes. They carry on ignorant of the majesty of God, oblivious to his presence and indifferent to what he requires of them. And so they hasten on without such a fear. There are types of fear that the unbelieving have, and that even in a measure or degree at times, the Lord's people can fall into. That would include, for example, slavish fear, fearing God merely or solely as a judge. So there's a sense in which there are some who think, well, God is this terror to me, and that is all that it is for them. And that, of course, kills love for God. Whereas with the Christian, the fear of the Lord actually engenders love for the Lord. But a slavish fear can never be connected with love for God. Someone who is terrified of another person cannot have that person as the object of their love. Not truly. It is more akin to the relationship of the slave to the whip. It drives us away from God, as we see with Cain, who is driven from the presence of the Lord. No, the Christian, in fearing the Lord, looks upon God in Christ Jesus. We look upon him in Christ through the prism, if you will, of the Redeemer as reconciling us unto himself, looking to him with hope. This is a godly fear in which God's majesty, while bringing a sense of deep-seated awe in our hearts at times, is also something that carries with it attraction. We worship the Lord in the beauty of his holiness. Well, none but the Christian can look upon God's holiness as beautiful. It brings with it a sense of abhorrence in relationship to sin. Those who are fearing the Lord most will abhor most sin. It will be those who will be most in love with the Lord and desirous to please him, to actually be near him, to draw near to him. And so the fear of God, rather than repelling, driving away the true Christian, the Christian is brought, as it were, to take off his sandals, as Moses did before the burning bush, and to peer into this glory that belongs to the Lord. So there's a sense he is the creator, we are the creature, and there's a sense of the difference that exists between his transcendence and our finite dependence upon him, and yet our hearts are drawn out to him. I've illustrated it by way of the angels who were sinless in their perfection, how they both cover and shield themselves from the glory. There's a sense of needing to be hid while also drawing near to adore him and to lift their voices in praise to him. The fear of God is fundamental to what it means to be a Christian. We are to serve him with fear and rejoice with trembling. Kings of the earth and judges are to do this. All creatures are to do this. We walk in our daily life as those who are fearing God. And there are things that we will not see or do, and there are things that we are compelled and drawn and desirous to see and do because the fear of God is found within our hearts. Fear of God, of course, characterizes a biblical worship all through the New Testament as well, both testaments. The fear of the Lord is part and parcel with biblical worship. It is not a casual affair. It is not a laugh fest. It is coming before the august glory of the God of heaven and paying the homage and worship that is due to his name. And the fear of the Lord characterizes that worship. And so the Lord looks upon, his eye is upon them that fear him. But then secondly, and this is the other side of the coin, secondly, hoping in his mercy. So the text says, behold, the eye of the Lord is upon them that fear him, upon them that hope in his mercy. Now think with me. The object of hope in this text is what? The object of hope is mercy. We are hoping in his mercy. The source of that hope is what? The source of the hope is faith. Faith is what breeds or produces hope in his mercy. And what is the ground of such a hope? Well, the ground can only be Christ himself. There would be no credible ground for the hope of mercy unless Christ himself were that ground. And so the object of our hope is mercy, the source is faith, and the ground is Christ. Now, as you've heard many times before, hope is not uncertainty. Hope is confident expectation. So there is a confident expectation in mercy. God's people have a confidence in their expectation of mercy, a full persuasion of the gracious goodness of God in his dealings with us. We know that God does not delight in the death of the wicked or in their misery, but rather he delights in showing to his people his compassion. In the Book of Lamentations, written by the prophet Jeremiah at a very, very difficult time in the history of Israel, the time of them being taken into exile. We read in Lamentations chapter 3, verse 33, "For he doth not afflict willingly, nor grieve the children of men." And so this is really the hope of the gospel itself. That's how Paul describes it in Colossians 1. He describes it as the hope of the gospel. Same thing as saying hope in God's mercy. We recognize that our hope is grounded in the honor of God's mercy, if you will, the honor of Christ's blood. God upholding, as it were, Christ's blood. And so for the Christian, this is joined to the fear of the Lord. So in our times of affliction, the Lord may be chastening us. There may be times when the Lord's chastening us, as we see in Hebrews 12, and it's painful and it's grievous, and we fear the Lord in it. We see that to offend the Lord is a grave thing, to defy the Lord, to turn away from the Lord, to ignore the Lord, to disobey the Lord. I mean, these are fearful things, and we experience it in the chastening that the Lord gives us. And yet, in that, even in chastening or whatever type of affliction and trial that we are facing, we have hope, confident expectation in mercy. And isn't that exactly what the Lord tells us? Right? He is going to bring forth the peaceable fruits of righteousness in those to those who are trained by it. That the Lord, in fact, is intending mercy. And we are as slow to believe this in the Lord's dealings with us as our children are in believing us in our dealings with them sometimes. Children are absolutely befuddled by the notion that chastening, that a spanking, actually has the aim of mercy in it, when it does. In fact, it is entirely aimed at the good of their own souls, and so it is with the Lord. We have hope of mercy and the provision of his help and support and protection of us. And our hearts are led to cry out, as we see in Psalm 42, verse 5, "Why art thou cast down, O my soul? Why art thou disquieted in me? Hope thou in God, for I shall yet praise him for the help of his countenance." There is, of course, the hope of heaven itself, which is the culmination of all of the mercies that God's given to us. Peter talks about this, Hebrews talks about this, Paul talks about this. The hope of heaven itself, where we are immersed, as it were, in the eternal mercies of God himself. So the Lord is saying, for the true Christian, the Lord is looking. You think to yourself, well, I'm reticent to hope in mercy. And yet it is when we are actually, through the exercise of faith, taking confidence in the Lord's mercy on the grounds of Christ, that the Lord is looking to us. He's delighting in us. He is drawing near to us, taking pleasure in us, if you will. Now, it would be a presumptuous hope if it's apart from Christ, if it's detached from the fear of God, if it is without means and marks, then that would be presumptuous. But a godly hope is founded in the free grace that is to be found in Christ. Our lives built upon him, his sanctifying mercies to us. Hope, after all, is one of the pieces of the Christian's armor in Ephesians chapter 6. The Lord is not delighted in despair. Right? Despair actually makes us sluggish in our Christian walk. An ungodly, unbelieving despair dismantles our delight in the Lord and our service of Him. He urges us in the gospel to hope in His mercy. This has power in it. And we see the Lord's power and His pity and His promises and His providential dealings with us. So first of all, we have the fear of the Lord. Secondly, hoping in His mercy. Thirdly, holding fear and hope together. So our third point is holding fear and hope together. Behold, the eye of the Lord is upon them that fear Him, upon them that hope in His mercy. Here we have a balance, if you will. Here we have a hedge on either side to hem us in. It's as if there are rocks on both sides. We're on the ship. We're in the sea. And there are rocks on one side and there are rocks on the other. And if we steer to one, it will smash us to smithereens. And if we steer to the other, it will cause us problems. And we must stay the course, as it were. We can be led on the one hand to despair, or on the other hand to presumption. We can be hopeless on one hand, or careless on the other. There can be carnal security, and there can be tormenting anxiety. We want neither the hypocrisy that comes with the absence of the fear of the Lord, nor the despondency that comes with the absence of hoping in His mercy. The Lord calls us to be watchful and composed. And so in prayer, what happens? If we merely have some sort of fear and nothing else, then we may grind through prayer as a bare duty, in our perverted minds, pacify an angry God. But if we have true fear of the Lord, a godly fear, coupled with hope, it draws us to the throne of grace. We are drawn to the Lord, and we have both reverence and sweet affection blended. Both reverence and sweet affection are being blended together in our Christian experience before the throne of grace. The lack of either of these is dishonorable to the Lord. He is in heaven, and will we not fear Him, we who are on the earth? He has in His Son purchased salvation for us, and will you not hope in His mercy after He has done all of that? You see, the gospel brings these things together. The sight of our sin, the sight of the Savior. It's the same all the way through the Christian life. We are walking in the fear of the Lord and the joy of the Holy Ghost, as we saw in Acts 9. We're walking in the fear of the Lord and in the hope of His mercy. And so as we come into different stages of life, the Lord in His providence brings us into a time of prosperity. Well, in that context, what are our risks? We can become proud. We can become careless, right? These would be obvious examples in times of prosperity. Remember how even in spiritual prosperity, Paul brings this out when he's speaking to the Corinthians in 2 Corinthians 12, that whole situation with the fear in the flesh is put in a context. Let's remember the context, verse 7, "And lest I should be exalted above measure through the abundance of the revelations." So this is a time of spiritual prosperity. And he says, lest I become careless, I'm proud, I'm exalted above measure, through these abundant revelations, there was given to me a thorn in the flesh to keep me low. So we read Paul saying to the Romans in chapter 11, warning us about being high-minded, right? He says in Revelation, is it verse 20? Or excuse me, Romans chapter 11, verse 20. But, he says, be not high-minded, but fear. So the fear of the Lord is what's needed. The Lord brings prosperity. We're not to be high-minded. We're to be walking in the fear of the Lord. Now, when trials come on the other side, or we're struggling acutely with our sins, we can become hopeless in those circumstances. And we can find ourselves struggling and wrestling, as it were. And it's in those circumstances that we desperately need to be clinging to this hope of mercy. Psalm 43, verse 5, similar to what we read in Psalm 42. Why art thou cast down, O my soul? There's despondency. Why art thou disquieted within me? There's anxiety. Hope in God. There's the answer. We're to be hoping in his mercy. Hope in God, for I shall yet praise him. And so on. Something similar can be found in Luke 19. And so here is the Lord, and he's saying these things are Siamese twins. They're held together. He is infinitely great. He is to be feared, and he is infinitely merciful, and he is to be loved and hoped in. And it is troubling. It is troubling for sin when we fail to mix these things. It is troubling and sinful when we fail to mix these things. The Lord wants us to have triumph in Christ and to have distaste for sin, both caution and confidence. And it's really, in a sense, it's the relationship of law and gospel, isn't it? Where you see the searching, penetrating influences of the law coupled with the soothing, consoling influences of the gospel. These are held together. So the fear prevents us from falling short, and hope promises us perseverance. Both of these are needed. In prosperity, fear. In calamity, hope. Both in every circumstance. So when you think of the future, well, there's one appointment on the calendar, unknown to us, but absolutely non-negotiable, and that is death. So we think about that last enemy, and we prepare for it, I trust, spiritually. Well, we think of death. There's a sense of that. This is a result of sin. This is the evil of sin. This is the finality. You know, we have accountability to the Lord that is due to him. We have the judgment that is to come, and so on. But that is always held together with the thought of glory, of heaven. And we can't think about death without thinking about heaven. Death is, in fact, the door that takes the Christian soul into the presence of the Lord. And you can see how both the fear of the Lord and hope in his mercy are being mingled in such reflections. The Lord gives us very clear instruction about what it means to attract his gaze. You know, we can say to you who are children and to young people, you're thinking about going out, as it were, into the world. Well, here is good counsel. Now, everything in the Bible, every verse, every word of the Bible would be good counsel in any circumstances, including young people. But here the Lord says, the eye of the Lord is upon them that fear him and that hope in his mercy. Here is something to guide, to direct, to gird up, and to influence the way in which we think. In our own nation, we have, you look at the nation as a whole, there's a misplaced hope. Right, they're hoping in princes and in horses and chariots, or they're hoping in the strength of the American dollar. They're hoping in this, that, or the other thing. It's a misplaced hope. It's not hoping for mercy that is to be found in Christ, in the gospel. And there's the absence of fear. They may fear terrorist attacks or economic collapse or other things, but the fear of the Lord isn't there. And this is what's dreadfully needed, both the fear of the Lord and hope in his mercy. The Lord takes pleasure in the Christian. His eye is fixed upon the Christian. There's a parallel passage in Psalm 147 in verse 11 where you have the same language, but instead of saying the eye of the Lord, look at what it says. the Lord, or Jehovah, taketh pleasure in them that fear him, in those that hope in his mercy. God himself delights in his people. Now, God is the one, of course, who produces these fruit in us by his grace, through the ministry of the Holy Spirit, the sanctifying influences of his word. God is teaching us and helping us grow in the fear of his name, and he's helping us grow in our confident expectation in his mercy. And he is delighting in the object of his people who are walking in these paths. This is what pleases him, what he is producing in us. He delights in the fruitfulness of growing up in the Lord and being found in the Lord Jesus Christ. So as the Christian reflects upon this most basic idea, I want to please the Lord. I want to be serving him in ways that delight him. I want the Lord's eye to be upon me, because my heart swells with love for him, because my heart swells with gratitude for all that he is and has done for me. Well, the Lord says, if that is the case, if that's part of the heart throb that you find within your own soul, then he gives us very clear help. Behold, the eye of the Lord is upon them that fear him, upon them that hope in his mercy. Let's stand together for prayer. Our gracious Lord and our God, indeed you are a dreadful God who is to be feared, a God who does not wink at sin, but holds every sinner to account. And you, O Lord, will bring to judgment every sin, from the smallest to the greatest. And you are to be feared as a God who is inflexible in your righteousness and holiness. And yet we rejoice that your judgment has indeed been fulfilled in the person of the Lord Jesus Christ on behalf of your people, and your wrath has been fully satisfied in him, and you have left for your people who are leaning upon Christ and walking in faith in him, you have left for us to be immersed in mercy. And we do, O Lord, on the ground of Christ Jesus and his glorious work, take great confidence in the expectation that indeed you will extend mercy to us day by day. Your mercies will be new every morning, for they are enduring mercy. So, Lord, grant that we would be a people who, like the godly of old, would be a people who indeed walk in the fear of the Lord, who hope in the Holy Ghost, and who hope in the mercy that is to be found in Christ Jesus. We ask in Jesus' name, amen. Let's respond to the reading and preaching of God's word by singing from Psalm 33, this portion we've just been considering, and verse 18 to the end. So verses 18 to 22, and here are the words of our text in the metrical version. Behold, on those that do him fear, the Lord doth set his eye, even those who on his mercy do with confidence rely. Verses 18 to 22, the tune is Edington, which is tune number 54.
With confidence. stand for the benediction. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.